Station. This is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston, this is Station. We're ready for the event.
The Boston Globe, this is Mission Control, Houston. Please call Station for a voice check.
Station, this is Joshua Miller. How do you hear me?
Hey, Joshua, I got you loud and clear. How me?
I hear you loud and clear. How are you up there? Hello from Boston, where we're getting buried under a whole lot of snow. Have you been able to see the storm from the ISS?
I have not been able to get to the window yet to look out there, but I was just having a conversation with our Capcom on the ground, and I didn't realize it was going to be such a bad storm. But I'm just going to have to get out there and take some pictures on the next pass, I think. 18 inches. That's almost as bad as the blizzard of 78, huh?
Yeah, it's getting up there, and it's almost as ferocious, about 3 inches an hour now. But it's great to be able to chat with you, and I appreciate your willingness to take the time. I know you're very busy. Back when you were a Massachusetts resident, were you a Dunkin' Donuts guy? And up there in space, do you have access to coffee? And if so, hot or iced?
You know, I used to live right down the streets from one of the first Dunkin' Donuts that was ever opened up. And it was a little bit of a hangout for the kids. But, no, we have some most excellent space food that's prepared mostly by NASA and our other agencies. And it tastes just as good.
That makes sense. You're a Randolph guy. Tell me a little bit about your upbringing and whether you were thinking about space and being an astronaut when you were a kid here in Massachusetts.
So I grew up in Randolph, Massachusetts. I went to a vocational high school, so I got a lot of hands-on experience, you know, welding and specifically a lot of design work as a mechanical or a machine draftsman. I loved it, had a lot of great friends. I still have some lifelong friends there that I keep in touch with. My mom is back there, my brother, my sisters. Everything is still home for me there. But I got interested in space and with a vocational type, technical type background. It was a smooth pull right into University of Massachusetts Dartmouth into mechanical engineering. And it kept leading to bigger and better things, and the space program was one of those things that was just in my soul.
When you were at UMass Dartmouth, what were you like? Were you sort of on track to be a military guy, straight and narrow, you know, focused on studying science, or did you have some fun, a little more of a party animal, and chilled out over time? Give me a sort of sense of what those years were like for you in Dartmouth.
Well, probably all of the above. So when I got there, I had already worked a few years nights at a bakery called Zeppi's Bagel Bakery in Randolph, Massachusetts. And I saved up enough money for my first year of college. But halfway through that first year of college, I realized that I was going to need a little bit more cash to keep going. So I actually enlisted in the United States Navy as a reservist. It was a little bit more than reserve. We did a lot of training in the summers and did a little bit more than one weekend a month. But it helped pay my tuition, and it gave me a little bit of living money to pay the rent and buy some books. So I had some really good friends. I still have lifelong friends from UMass Dartmouth and contacts back there. We had a very tight-knit group. We studied a lot. We had some fun and hung out together and grew up together. It was a really good experience.
Are there things about, you've obviously had a military career and now a NASA career that's taking you to many other places, Maryland and space. Are there particular things about Massachusetts that you think back on now and miss?
You know, I like the spring and I like the fall in Massachusetts. Two great seasons, very distinct from the summer and the winter. Some of the other places I've lived are much milder than what we see up in New England. But I have family up in New England. My friends and family are there. And when I think about New England, I think about those people in general.
Tell me a little bit about your career in the military. Do you feel like you tried to shape it? Was the goal of it to be able to apply to NASA and be able to get into the space program, or was that something later in your time in the Navy?
So the thing with setting a lofty goal, like becoming an astronaut, there's so many things that can prevent you from doing it, whether that are out of your control, whether it be timing, whether it be program, whether it be medical, whether it be academic, depending on the needs of the country at the time. So you really got to be happy with your journey to that goal. And as I looked at it, I was definitely going to be happy being an engineer. So I went to engineering school, to UMass Dartmouth and then Purdue. Being a test pilot was good, and that was something that, if that's as far as I got, I would be very happy with. So I went to go be a test pilot in the Navy, and a fighter pilot first, and then into a, being a test pilot. And then after test pilot, I was moving into the program world in the developmental systems for NAVAIR and Naval Air down at Patuxent River. So it all led to this big goal, but I would have been happy at any one of those goals had had that been it.
Tell me a little bit about precisely what a flight engineer does, you know, what your training, you know, give me a précis of your training, and what your day-to-day life is like on ISS currently.
Yeah, so on ISS, right now we have a current USOS crew of three Americans and one Japanese, and we have two Russians on the Russian segment. We typically get up around 6 o'clock or so. We start preparing, have breakfast, and preparing for the for a work day. And we'll have a mix of activities, whether it be maintenance on a life support system or move into conducting some science. Whether it be, you know, a little bit of combustion research or a little bit of fluids research or setting up the systems that that are going to move and transition into new experiments. We have on the order of 200 to 250 experiments running at any given time on the space station. So it can get pretty busy. And we try to manage all of that. Right now, we have Dragon attached, which is one of our cargo vehicles provided by SpaceX. And so we're spending a little bit of time packaging up some return items and getting those that cargo moved on to Dragon so that they can undock in the next couple of weeks and head home.
Give me an example of an experiment that that might be understandable to folks back home here.
Sure. Well, one of the experiments I'm working on is called Apex, and they send up seeds in petri dishes that are in a solution, and we put them in an incubator, and we look at them to see how the seeds germinate. We take pictures. They take the ground team takes measurements on them, and they're doing their research to figure out how plants and how organic materials will germinate. In space, and that has a direct impact on, one, making our process maybe a little more efficient back at home, and two, so that we can start learning how to feed ourselves as we head into longer duration missions, such as to the moon or to Mars.
And just help me understand how your particular job up there differs from those of your American or Russian colleagues as flight engineer.
Well, they don't. We're all working the same timelines, and we're all working the same programs, and it just depends on how they even out the workflow and how they even out the how we transit back and forth into in between jobs. We do have EVAs that are coming up that we're getting ready to go outside and do a little maintenance outside. So that'll be the first one will be Vandahai and myself, and the next one will be Vandahai and Norishige. And Joe will be helping us out from inside the International Space Station. But in general, we're all trained the same. We're all trained to do approximately the same tasks so that we can plug and play and get the mission objectives completed.
What do you miss most about Earth currently?
Well, what I miss most about Earth are my family and friends. That goes without saying. But below that, I was just thinking the other day, it'd be really good to have a nice hot shower. I've only been here for 3 weeks, so I only get four and a half or 5 months to go.
And can you FaceTime with your kids from space?
We have video conference capability, so on special days such as their birthday or the holidays, we can set up a video conference and spend 45 minutes or an hour talking, or I can call them on our IP phone, assuming that we have satellite coverage, and we always have email.
Final question for you. What's the first restaurant meal you plan to have when you come back to the United States of America?
Well, I haven't really been planning that all out, but it's probably going to be at a restaurant, our favorite family restaurant, right down the street with the whole family, and we'll just sit down and have a good old-fashioned meat and potatoes dinner.
Sounds good. Thank you so much for your time, sir.
Thank you, Joshua. Appreciate your patience. Have a great day, and stay warm.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you, all participants with the Boston Globe. Station, please stand by while we reconfigure video and audio communications. Thank you.